I think we're ready to start. So as I said, hello and welcome to today's webinar. Today we're looking at the exam day countdown for B2 First to C2 Proficiency. And this is actually the second in a series of sessions about the exam day countdown. And if you would like to watch the other session by my colleague Alberto Costa, he looked at the young learner test, so pre-A1 starters, A1 movers, A2 flyers, A2 key for schools, and B1 preliminary school for schools, and the exam day countdown tips and suggestions for those levels. So today we're focusing on the higher levels from B2 first, as I said, first for schools, to C1 proficiency. And we'll be looking at tips for teachers and learners in that countdown. My name is Sarah Ellis, and I work in the assessment services team. I'm based in Italy, and so today I'm speaking to you from Bologna in Italy. And I'm here with my colleague, Paola Della Loggia, also with Eve in the background, who will be helping in the chat. Okay, so we're going to be looking at the exam day countdown. As we think about the end date, so the date of the actual exam, what we do in that run-up to the exam date. We'll be thinking about the learner and the learner needs, and in particular, we're going to be focusing on building a positive mindset and a positive approach to the exam day. And then we're going to be considering some of those last minute learner questions that learners may ask you in that last, those special moments before special run up to the exam date. And then we're going to be looking at some teaching ideas to help with that countdown and some practical suggestions. And of course, with these, we will be suggesting links and ideas, and we'll make sure that you receive these links after the webinar. There will also be some links in the chat if you wish to take note of them today. So here we go. The exam countdown has begun. So you have your date, and you as the teacher have probably completed the syllabus and thought about preparing your learners for every paper and for every exam task that they're going to have at the level of the exam they're taking. So what happens now? Well, often in exam countdown, it would look something like this, perhaps doing some self-study. Of course, that's very important. And of course, thinking about exam papers, perhaps recycling, looking at old ones, looking at examples of the exam papers. And then, of course, we can also be looking at maybe doing a mock exam and maybe also looking at revision in class. Now, that's one way of looking at it, but it's not the only way we can look at it. Because, of course, exam day can also mean working in groups, discussion, perhaps practicing those language skills while we think about the preparation for the exam day and exploiting the topic of the exam to also do some speaking practice and think about exam strategies together as a group. It's also a good moment to be thinking about talking to you as the teacher, looking at your looking at questions that they may have, and helping them to have the confidence to be ready for that final exam day. And of course, we have whatever length of your course, you might have been doing course over several months, or you might be doing a short exam preparation course. But you're basically, as a teacher, helping that transition from what they do in the classroom to being prepared through that period of study to be ready to perform and do their best on exam day. So it's about creating opportunities to explore, practice language, consolidate language with that end goal of the exam in mind. And of course, during this transition or this journey, let's say, it's about giving them tools so that they understand what they have to do, so that that really helps them to prepare and to be able to showcase, if you like, to showcase their language knowledge and their skills on exam day, which of course is the goal for everyone, that they can do their best when they get there in that exam room. So we start by thinking about the learner and understanding the needs of the individual learners that we have in our group to think about what's best for them. But the first thing to really focus on is building that growth mindset. This may be something you've already been doing over the course, but certainly in the run-up to the exam, it's really important that students can think about what they can do and about showcasing what they've been studying during the course that they've been doing. So very much developing I can mentality, which will help confidence and help in a calmer approach, let's say, to exam day. So in preparation for that, there is an activity, and you can see the aims of this activity. It's a pyramid discussion, and it's an activity that we have adapted for the webinar, but it is very much something that obviously you can do in a face-to-face classroom as well. But let's just think a little bit about the aims of this activity, and it really is about building that positive growth mindset, I can mindset, so that students are going to be better able to perform, as I said. So what we want to do is get students to think about that mindset and create that attitude, if you like, towards their approach to their exam. So we need to talk about it. So talking about that experience and making an exam day plan in that countdown that can help them with a very clear plan to be ready for the big day. So let's try the task. And here I'd like to invite you to participate in the chat. So let's explore the language of exams and what that experience is about, because what we want to do is reflect on attitudes and beliefs about success and failure in the exam, and then ultimately to share some useful exam strategies. So let's start with this part of exploring the way we think about an exam and what it's like to actually take an exam. So I've just got an example. So if we talk about to prepare for an exam, what other verbs do we use in the connection with, let's say, the language of exam? So to prepare for an exam is one. So I'll just give you a moment to write in the chat any other ideas you have to add to this list. So prepare for an exam is just one. Let's see what else you've got. Okay, to check. Super, lots of answers coming in quickly. To revise for an exam, get ready, to study. Okay, I like this, practice. And to fix, that's interesting. To rehearse, that's a nice word to use there. To practice for the exam, to perhaps do some listening practice, for example. To strengthen their knowledge, enhance. I love this, lots of revise. And practicing a lot, reading about the exam, okay, reviewing their knowledge and get mentally prepared for the exam, lovely. And practice makes perfect, so yes, absolutely, thank you for that one. And of course, brush up on the topics and doing different types of exercises. So lots of super ideas, absolutely. I haven't got all your ideas in my list, but let's have a look at some other ideas that we have here. So we have also to revise for an exam, which many of you mentioned, to take an exam or to do an exam, to pass an exam. And of course, we also have to fail an exam. And then, of course, we have to retake an exam. So if we think about these collocations, probably many of these words will stimulate your own emotions and perhaps remind you of your own exams, exam taking experience, if you think about your own, the exams that you've taken in your lifetime. So we're stimulating a range of emotions here. So let's just talk a little bit more about that range of emotions. So getting students to think about the language of the exams like we've just done and how they make them feel about the exams in response. So again, invite you to put a word in the chat. So thinking about adjectives of emotion here, let's think about your feelings about taking an exam. So I'd like you to write one adjective of emotion in the chat box to describe how you feel about taking exams. So let's just give you a moment for that. Excited, nervous, confident, stressed, nice range of vocabulary coming out here. Distressed, feverish, self-confident. Okay, so we've got a good range here. Anxious, optimistic, lovely, challenged, terrified, okay, and hopeful, okay, a little bit frustrated, says Maria, worried about the results, thinking ahead, anxious, perhaps uncertain. So lots of interesting words associated here. Overwhelmed, wow. Okay, so we've got, again, a range of positive and negative adjectives coming out. Now, let's think about it from the point of view of your learners now and what you think your learners would reply to the same question. So one word in, or what you think about your learners, one word in the chat box to describe how your learners feel about taking exams. Again, I can see some words coming very quickly, fed up, nervous. Impatient, unsure, anxious, afraid, terror, oh dear, ready, nervous, relieved, worried, excited, puzzled. Okay, so there's some different adjectives coming out here. So thank you for those. And of course, we're building a list of feelings, both positive and negative. So of course, what we can do in the classroom is to elicit this vocabulary and put it on the board. You might want to do it digitally, perhaps creating a word cloud using something like mentimeter.com, which is also free to use. And you can create a word cloud with these emotions and share that digitally. Or, of course, you can share it on the board. So now, of course, you have the resources for a class discussion. And that takes us to the next stage in the activity, which, of course, we get the students to now work in small groups. And the idea is that they review the adjectives that have been written on the board or in the word cloud. And then, of course, we're asking them to think about the positive adjectives. And we're staying with the theme of taking an exam. So we're kind of contextualizing the adjectives here. And then, of course, the negative adjectives related to taking an exam. So we have the two sides of the story, if you like. And then, of course, at B2, C1 and C2, we're looking at, in the speaking test, doing a lot of comparing and contrasting. And so here we actually have an example of, to be able to do it in a real context. So if we ask the students to compare and contrast the positive emotions with the negative emotions about exams, of course, we have a rich discussion to discuss why they you might feel positive. So we saw quite a few interesting adjectives in the chat. And so why would they, might they feel positive about it? And then, of course, we may have them doing the same thing. What makes you feel negative emotions about exam? Again, they discuss and compare and contrast perhaps their experience in different subjects, in different contexts, so that we have the opportunity also to be practicing speaking, in fact, as well as thinking about the context of the exams. Now, very importantly is also to think about the steps that they could take to counteract any of these negative emotions. Because ultimately, of course, what we're trying to do is build that positive mindset. So it's useful to, of course, think of solutions around those negative emotions to at least help and support students who might be feeling some of those emotions as well. So, having looked at those adjectives, now is a moment to get some feedback from the class. And we can start with the whole class feedback. So ideas relevant to making a plan, if you like, for the whole group. And we can perhaps elicit it by using this kind of chart. You know, things we as a group can do to prepare for the test, and things we can do to feel our best on the exam day. So, for example, we can build up a sort of action plan based on this. And of course, I'm taking this resource from the mock test toolkit. And again, as I said at the beginning, we'll make sure that you have the resources. This is the mock test toolkit for the older learners. There's also one for younger learners. And having looked at it as a group, of course, it's also important to look at the individual, or the individual looks at ideas for an action plan. So again, these are the kind of things that we might expect students to be coming up with, you know, thinking about what they can do. So check that they understand how to approach the tasks in each paper, for example. So that kind of gets them to focus on the whole exam. And identify the tasks that they need to work on. And they've still got time because we're in the run-up to the exam. So they can perhaps do something about it before they get to exam day. And then, of course, we've got practical suggestions about how to feel best on exam day. I'm sure we've all heard that it's a good idea to go to bed early the night before you take an exam. And of course, let's take a step back now from the activity. So thinking about it, if you like, from a teacher's point of view, what is the value of doing this kind of pyramid discussion around exams for the learner? So, of course, what we're trying to do here is get the learners to generate their own ideas about effective exam preparation. So not just from the teacher or reading a list, but actually being involved in generating their own ideas there. Of course, because we're doing a discussion and we're in the context of something very real for them, obviously they can really relate to it. So if you like, there is this opportunity for meaningful spoken communication and that exchange of ideas that we were talking about. And that in itself gives an opportunity to focus on the kind of functional language and more sophisticated, eliciting more sophisticated versions of that as well, as we're looking at those higher levels for asking for exchanging opinions, perhaps giving advice, which of course will be useful also when they get to the speaking part of the exam. So we've got that kind of opportunity to really use the task for something real. And of course, the action plan itself helps the learner have some kind of confidence that they're working towards that exam day. They have a plan that they can follow, that they can check on, and they can measure their progress against, but it helps them to focus very clearly on that exam day. So, again, just to review the activity as we've been looking at it, the aim is definitely about growing that growth mindset around exams, being positive towards the experience and activating language around the exam. So we looked at just a few collocations there. And of course, you could explore that further to look at more complex language if you wish. And then, of course, we can look again at adjectives about how exams make them feel. So we elicit that, then get the students to group the adjectives into positive and negative. So this is basically a lesson plan that we have here. And then we can create the compare and contrast discussion around the adjectives. Then as a kind of a summary of it and as a follow-up is getting the students to think about their own countdown action plan. and also for the group as a whole, in that sound of sense of support within the group. It's an experience that most of the students, if not all the students in the group, will be heading towards. So it's a good idea to also create that sense of community and sharing of experience and strategies in the class. Now, there are some tools to use, and again, these are downloadable. So we have a study plan template. This particular person has got 4 weeks before their exam date. They can think about the areas they want to focus on and maybe think about their score if they've done a mock test. There's also a little checklist, which I think is quite useful because it just reminds them of some of the very practical things. It is useful, of course, to check that you've got the date and the time and the location of the exam. If it's somewhere they're not familiar with, then checking how long it takes to travel so that they don't get there the last minute or have that bad experience of having difficulty traveling there, so they can plan ahead for that. And then, of course, to make sure they're registering for their online results service so that they'll be able to check their results as soon as they're available. And then on the exam day, useful tips, of course, is to have your ID ready. And of course, the equipment that you need if you're doing the paper-based test, then obviously having pens and pencils available and ready. Also, the other tips, so that, again, to reduce anxiety on the exam day, is to remind them that if they want to take water, they have to take it in a clear plastic bottle without any labels, because, of course, for obvious reasons, they can't have anything that's got anything written on. And also, another one that I would add is that now, of course, the student will not be able to wear a watch during the test. You can imagine for all the digital versions of watches, it is now not possible to wear a watch in the exam room. They will have a clock in the exam so that they will be able to see the time. But I think just psychologically, knowing that you're not going to be looking at your own watch is very important. And of course, if they take the computer-based version, they'll have a clock on screen. But if it's paper-based, they'll have a clock in the room. So there is an example here. This student focusing on the improving their listening, strategies for staying calm, perhaps, and they're obviously thinking about their range, making sure they've got a range of vocabulary and grammar. This is just an example study plan with some sort of tips of the kind of things students might be considering, looking at vocabulary every day, perhaps having a speaking buddy or perhaps doing some activities like exam lift, but there may be other apps that students can use to help them practice just before the test. And I'll just mention a couple of those as we go along. But that's just an example. And again, this is available in the mock test toolkit. This is another opportunity, of course, to get them to be thinking about the resources that may be helping them with their learning. So, for example, using the Cambridge Learners Dictionary online, which is free to use, they sign up, create their profile, and within the profile, they can create their own word list. If they haven't already been doing this during the course, this may be a way to help them focus on vocabulary on different topics and also use the testing function, the game functions that help them revise them for the exam day. So again, there's a little video which you can watch or your students can watch, which is very, very brief, that just tells them how to use this dictionary. And it's obviously a very important tool in that revision stage, as many of you were talking about revision. Here's an example of a student who's working on idioms with as, and they can create their own word list. And this might be add as easy as pie to one of your lists below, or to create a new word list. And of course, hopefully they will find that they're so well prepared that the exam, they come out and say, oh, it was easy as pie. But no, joking apart, it's a very nice way to help students create those word lists, especially at these higher levels, so that they can explore the pronunciation, check on meaning, and broaden their own vocabulary. And then exam lift, if up to B2, these are short activities that are daily available to practice all the skills. And so students may like to sign up for that, and they get things like this for phrasal verbs. It's a bit gamification, but it's very sound practice, and they will have a certain amount each day. And when they've finished, they have to wait for the next day, so they can't get too addicted to it, and they can look forward to the next day of activities to use in their revision process. And of course, you can see some of the reasons why it will be useful to use it here. And of course, this might be about a particular part of the exam. Now, another activity I think is really useful to consider is to think about the future and to get your students to imagine that this is them in the future with their Cambridge English Qualification certificate in their hand. So they've done the exam, they've got the certificate, and basically we want the students to work in twos to do an interview, if you like, and it's called a future interview because, of course, the student is imagining themselves there in the future, looking back over that exam journey and being interviewed by their peer. So they have to think about what's the best thing about having passed the exam. So thinking about that motivation or the experience, what was the biggest motivation. Think of one obstacle. This can be quite useful for a student to think about one area that they are challenged by and think about how they overcame it. And also to think about what people helped them pass the exam or what activities helped them feel that they were ready for the exam. How did they do that? And last but not least, a good thing to talk about is what exam would they give to someone else who's taking the exam? So in that interview, they talk about that so that they're also the mindset of thinking about that journey and being successful, hopefully, can also be useful. So moving into the last minute questions and the teacher question situation, which you may have, countdown to exam day has started and you might get some questions. What about, what if, what happens when? And I wonder what kind of questions you get near the exam from your students. So could you tell me the kind of questions you get just before exam day and that countdown to exam day? What if I fail? Okay. Is there an exam? Can you give me any tips? Okay. Important question. What if I'm late? Okay. Useful, practical questions. Okay. How many times do we hear the listening, etc.? Okay. When is the exam? Very important. Okay. How long is each part? Mm-hmm. What if I don't take the exam? Okay. Right. Okay. And what if, okay, lots of things there. What about if I'm sick and unable to, good, useful, practical questions. And of course, we need to be thinking about being ready with answers to many of those. Now, before they start answering all your questions in the chat, I'll just show you an activity that's related to that. So thank you for your questions. And here are some questions that I have to offer you. And I think some of them you will have asked in the chat. I wasn't able to see all the questions. But if we have a look at these, let's think if any of those were questions that your students might ask. And, you know, what if I don't understand all the words in the text? And, of course, related to writing, what happens if I need more paper? What if I write too much or don't write enough? I think we've all heard these questions. And of course, other questions about listening. How important is spelling? Can I wear headphones? So again, practical questions. What if my partner in the speaking test is better than me at speaking? That's an interesting one, isn't it? And can my teacher be my examiner? Well, one of the things is that we can check out those the answers to those typical questions in the information for candidate booklets, and these are available for each of the levels, so you can look at the exam that's of interest to you. And what we can do is create an activity about it, so creating an exam day countdown activity. Now, some of you might like to do it digitally, perhaps using something like Kahoot. And here is an example of using it using Kahoot. So let's just play. So I'm going to do the offline version just to be sure. And I'm going to show you some questions and I'd like you to join in and answer in the chat. So here's the first question. And if you'd like to choose the answer. So we have two answers. So is it A or is it B? And again, if you can write that in the chat, what do you think? Okay, so we've got some different answers there. So that's fine. And then of course the clock is ticking away with Kahoot, da 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 da, and then we'll show them the answer. So the answer is, it's actually counted as two words. Okay, so there's the first question. Question number two, what if I don't understand all the words in the text? Again, this time we have three options to choose from. And what do you say about that one? So again, give you some time to answer in the chat. Okay, lots of C's there. Definite lots of C's. Okay, thank you for that. And of course, you're absolutely right. They need to work it out in context. And the next question, very quickly, what happens if I need more paper? So quite a practical question. And we have two answers. Is it A or B? Okay. Again, we've got a slight range of questions, but with the majority going for A. And indeed, it is, of course, A. They put their hand up. It's worth saying that if at any time they need anything, not to speak to anyone, not to stand up, but to put their hand up, and an invigilator will come to them. Now, when we talk about more paper, it's worth saying that we're talking about making notes on the paper, because the actual answer, of course, must be on the question paper. So they're not writing their answer on the sheets of paper that they're using for their notes. It must be on the question paper, so or the answer sheet that they should be writing on. So just remind them, and also to remind them that if they are writing any notes, they will not be allowed to take them out of the room. Any spare paper that they've been using has to be left in the exam room. Very serious that they must do that, and of course the invigilators will be checking. So what about this question about my speaking? My teacher can be my examiner, and again we've got two options. What do you think about that one? Okay, so we've got some very knowledgeable people here, as because, again, in the Cambridge English qualifications, it's absolutely your teacher can't be your examiner. And obviously the exam centre is very careful to make sure that the examiners do not know the exam candidates. So it's very important that students know that it's not going to be you and it can't be you, so or an exam or one of their teachers. So what about listening and wearing headphones? Now, again, we have some different options. What do you think about that one? Okay, we've got a range of answers. And I'm just going to say that with the case of listening, if you're doing a paper-based exam, you need to check with your exam centre, because some exam centres will be using headphones if they're doing a paper-based, and some exam centres may be using a good stereo system in the room, so they won't necessarily be wearing headphones. So best to check with your exam centre if you're doing a paper-based. Of course, if you're doing the computer-based version of the exam, then you have to wear headphones, so there's no question about it. And if you're not someone who wants to use Kahoot, well, of course, we can do a different version of this kind of countdown quiz, day quiz. And that, of course, would be to create your own worksheet with similar kinds of questions that we saw in the Kahoot, and basing your questions on the candidate information booklet. Obviously, you may not want to ask the same questions in the same order, but this allows you to have both questions and answers. So you give out your worksheet and then the pairs discuss their answers to the questions. And then you might do some feedback, so you can also pick up the kind of questions that they're asking and the kind of uncertainty that they might have, and then give out the question answer section from the booklet relevant to the level that you're teaching, so that the students can search for the answers and get the correct information. Obviously, they have to locate the information. Then, of course, they discuss the answers and whether they were what they had said when they were doing it together. And of course, stepping back again from the learner's point of view, from the teacher, why you might be using it with the learner, what is the value to the learner of this task, is it really is useful to be able to deal with unanswered questions, because that can cause learner exam anxiety. So really important that they get reliable, correct information. So any of those certainties you've got rid of, that takes away another level of the stress. And of course, the guide for learners has been thought through with lots of questions from around candidates all over the world who have similar worries and concerns. And so the candidate information does help make sure that they've got the right information, and that also they might be encouraged to answer more questions about the exam. Of course, because we've been doing the activities, it also gives them a chance to practice their language skills around the topic of it taking the exam, which, of course, is very poignant and relevant to them at this stage in the course. So it's the kind of it's the final countdown. What do we focus on? Well, of course, we've got a little mini list here to think about each part of the exam, thinking about the useful areas to review. In writing, it's looking at those three stages of planning, checking and editing, and we'll have a brief look at that. In reading and use of English, of course, it's about just dealing with unfamiliar vocabulary, listening, thinking about the strategies that they can use while they're doing the listening. And of course, speaking is that ongoing practice to build confidence so that they can perform the best on the exam day. So there are a couple of activities to check out. Again, these are taken from a variety of sources, which we'll give you. And for example, for writing, we can think about this. I've taken an example for B2, but of course, it could equally be relevant for C2. C1 and C2, and in fact, very much so, because of course, in writing, this is where they need to showcase what they know, what they can do. And of course, the top tips for this really is that they remember to plan, to check, and to edit. And at those higher levels, checking and editing can really make a difference into the, obviously, the richness of the writing that they complete, and various other things about making sure they've answered the question, etc. Why is this important? Because it improves their performance without a doubt. Of course, that's it. Thank you. Yep. And so all the criteria for writing are very important, but there are two in particular that we can help with at this last stage. One is checking the question and making sure that the candidate has really answered the task and done what they should do, kept on topic, and been relevant, because it's not an advantage, of course, to be adding irrelevant content in terms of this category, this criterion. And of course, the other area, of course, is looking at the organization, making sure that it's put together well, logically ordered, and they're thinking about the reader, that it's easy for the reader to follow, and it's obviously organized appropriately according to the exam question. And then I would say, at these higher levels, remembering the reader, of course, is absolutely essential and can make a difference to the way they write and the way they are scoring in this particular part of the test. So we can get them to brainstorm ideas around the topic. So this is just an example of the essay question at B2, but it could be obviously at C1 or C2. So here's the question. The teacher asks you to write an essay about the reasons to learn a foreign language. There are more reasons to learn a foreign language than just pass the test. Do you agree? Now, what I would like you to do is just say, do you agree there are more reasons to learn a foreign language than just to pass the test? And why or why not? Just give me a couple, if you can, in the chat. Okay. Okay, you definitely agree. Okay, to communicate, for traveling. Communication, they're coming in fast now. To watch films, working opportunities, so looking ahead, widens the horizon to help to get a better job, understand other cultures, become a citizen of the world, absolutely fantastic. lots of ideas. Of course, you have many. And what we can do, of course, is get the students to do the main brainstorm without the essay question, and then we focus on the extension in the essay question. So here, of course, is an essay. What do they have to do? They have to do all the notes, they have to give reasons, and of course, they have to write about, you know, two given things at case of B2, and of course, they have to add their own ideas. So very briefly, we're getting our students to, from that initial brainstorm, now be thinking about what ideas are based on the reasons for pleasure, and what are the ideas related to personal challenge. And then, of course, we've got that extra area for them to be sharing their ideas on why learning a foreign language is a good idea. And then in class, once we've done that kind of brainstorm, we can look at some sample answers. You may have been doing this, but certainly in the run-up to the exam, looking at sample answers and evaluating them, particularly related to organisation and structure. And we, of course, for each level, you can go to the handbook for teachers. And in the handbook for teachers, you will find the appropriate assessment criteria for writing with the categories. And of course, when you look at the assessment criteria, it's useful just to remember that 3 is on level in terms of the criteria to be achieved. And just as a kind of reminder about that. So using these with your students, that's where you get them from. We give them a sample essay, and I've taken a sample essay from another source. There are sample answers in the handbook, and there are sample answers in these assessment guides for writing, and again we'll give you these in the resources, which allow students to consider the organization. So we can immediately see how many paragraphs there are, how are they linking the organization, etc. We can get them to mark it from 1 to 5, and of course, look at the feedback available in the handbook or available in the guide or available in the practice tests, because many of the Cambridge University practice tests also have this kind of activity. And of course, getting them to think about the feedback and why they might agree or disagree. So here we have the essay that we saw before. We've asked them to look at organisation. This is the information we get in the guide. And what is nice to do, we can see it's a 4. Okay, it's a 4. So let's explore what the answer gave us and where in the text are the linking words and cohesive devices that have been mentioned, so that we're reading and appreciating how that's working. Then, of course, we can get the students perhaps to rewrite this essay or another essay, but keeping the main ideas and perhaps using better cohesive ideas to structure and connect the ideas better. And then having done that outside, come to class the next lesson, look at their peers' essay, look at the changes that have been made and the way their structure has been improved. Interestingly, looking at the changes and the impact on the reader, as I said, at these higher levels, that's very important. And of course, to discuss and review in as a whole class. So what's the point of doing that? Well, of course, the ideas generation around part one of the essay question, we know there's going to be the essay question, being able to generate those ideas quickly, to be thinking about the organisation, and of course, just reminding themselves of how they're going to be evaluated, how can they benefit from the kind of feedback that those sample answers have been given, and how can they focus on organisation and rewrite the sample answer and do it better. And of course, talking about the impact of the structure and the cohesion of the writing. So you will find in the guides for writing lots of tips, lots of ideas, focusing on different criteria to help both the teacher and the learners to really focus in on those and understand them better. Here, for example, we look at the language in communicative achievement and whether it's straightforward or more complex. And you will, of course, get a commentary about each of the criteria, which you may want to have a look at. But as I say, at this late stage, it's really important to look at those organisation and the organisation and the content of it. So here we have the writing guides for the three levels. And again, as I said, we will make sure that you will receive the links for those. Also, when we're talking about writing, getting our students to work as independently as possible, we can use Write and Improve. This is actually available for all levels. The learners can select a task, and of course, we can select an appropriate task for B2, C1 or C2. Submit the task, and they will get automated digital feedback. So it's marked by artificial intelligence and related to the CFR. They don't get a score, but they get a CFR level. It also allows them to make changes in response to feedback. And of course, they can resubmit and get further feedback. The feedback will come, they get in 15 seconds. So it really allows them to work independently and to do much more writing so that they can get more practice and get feedback quickly. And it looks like this. It's a website. And again, I think Paola will put this in the chat so that you have that website straight away. You can sign up for it for free. It's best to have a profile so that they can watch the history of the writing. And you will see tasks like this B2 task, which is the essay task with the same kind of instructions if you have in the exam. And of course, the students can do it with using the task timer, which I think is really useful in the run up to the exam. Doing it under timed conditions helps them have that confidence that they're going to cover the task in the time. And I think, again, that's a particular feature. They write the task on the left. They will get feedback on the right. And this one is a low example at B1, but you can just get the idea of the fact that they get feedback. They get some suggested corrections, which they can edit and then send it back. And of course, they can see the progression of every time they check their writing on the bottom. You can see, and they can see the changes that they have made. Fantastic tool. Certainly at these higher levels where they needed as much writing practice as possible, I really recommend it. Now, thinking about listening. Again, students are often a little bit nervous about listening in the exam. So the more we can get them to be prepared and think about how they can use strategies in the exam, it's very important. So apart from doing obviously exam tasks, we can also exploit the audio script from the exam paper. So in the handbook or in maybe in your course book to get them to work with the audio script, to find the correct answers to the questions, and perhaps to find the correct answers, especially to the ones that they got wrong, thinking about why they might have got the answer wrong, and perhaps sharing those ideas on the board so that we can discuss it, eliciting reasons why they might get it wrong. And of course, common reasons why they might get it wrong include pronunciation or the accent of the speaker, unknown words and dealing with that, writing down the first thing they heard. Maybe they felt it was a bit too fast or they got distracted. So talking about that, talking about using the first listening and the second listening, because of course they get the second listening as well, is very important. And we can follow that up by playing it again, reading the audio scripts as we listen, comparing the answers. And then, as we said, we thought about writing to why they were wrong. The learners can work in pairs and think about these exam strategies, underlining, predicting, writing an answer, even when they don't. I'll just go back to that, sorry. Writing an answer, even when they're not sure. It's important to say it's better to write an answer than no answer, because not writing an answer is a wrong answer. So it's something really important to say in terms of listening. And of course, this task is taken from the mock test toolkit. So you can look at this at your leisure. And there's also one for ideas for looking at reading and use of English, again, to be adapted for the level that you are preparing your students for. Now, we've looked at writing, we've been thinking a little bit about listening, and I think it's also useful to think about speaking, because of course this is the day of the performance, if you like, so we want our students to feel as confident and as relaxed as possible by, you know, obviously being familiar with the tasks that they're going to have during the exam. Of course, all the three levels that we're talking about will have the personal introduction at the beginning, where students will be asked to react to different questions. This is for B2, this is for C1. Very often they're asked a question, which of course they can extend by answering the question why, giving a reason for their answer, an opportunity for them to extend their answer and to show more language. And of course, we have the same also at C2. One thing I like to suggest is, you may do this already, but if you're not getting your students to record, there are different ways of recording your students. Of course, there are many free apps to do that, and perhaps using their phone. But also one thing that you can use is Google Docs voice typing. It works very simply. And if you're using Google Docs, you go to the tools section and you find the voice typing section here. And then you choose the English that you want to have. I've chosen UK English just because I come from the UK, but there are obviously different varieties of English that you can choose from. And then we can click to speak. And this is me speak, having recorded myself. Speak.
So, I'm Sarah. I'm from UK, but I'm living and working in Italy at the moment. My mother was a teacher. And when I was younger, I always said, oh, I don't want to be a teacher. But here I am, many years later, and very happy to be a teacher. So that's my story. What about you?
So there's a very simple recording, and the computer is typing as I spoke, and of course it will type what it understands. So this is a really good example of being comprehensible. It's not about accent, but if you're comprehensible, the computer will type what you've said. So I think it's quite a nice way to check that the student is being comprehensible. And of course they can look at what they've done and also extend their answer, perhaps extend their ideas, connect their sentence better, thinking about linking words, thinking about different vocabulary, and perhaps avoiding repetition. So a very simple way to get more practice. And of course, we can give them random topics to speak about as they record. And of course, the variety will help them practice being ready for any topic. And of course, always with that, give a reason if you can as well. And of course, for all the levels, there are lesson plans and study plans. So this is a study plan to encourage independence at B2 for practicing for the B2 speaking test. And you can get the students to use these study plans individually and record themselves. Again, it's encouraging them to record themselves, and the instructions are there in the study plan. Also, to help with confidence before the exam, it may be a good idea to have a look at the YouTube speaking test videos. These are examples of students taking the exam. It helps students know what to expect. They can perhaps talk about the performance of the students in the videos. There are notes about the marks that they receive from the speaking examiners, which can help them think about strategies to do well, to make sure that they're communicating with their partner, that they're using the long turn well, etc. So it's a good place for students to just remind themselves of what's coming in the exam and to be more confident about the experience. So again, that's got different videos of different levels as examples for you to use. So that really brings me to summarizing and leave a little bit of time for a couple of questions. So really what we've been looking at is thinking about, we've got the exam day, the countdown, the clock is ticking. What can we do that is going to help students have that positive attitude, remind themselves of their exam strategies that are going to help them on the day, to perform at their best. So, of course, as teachers, we're looking at understanding learners' needs, understanding some of their preoccupations, and building a positive mindset, that can-do mindset that they need for the exam day, of course. Thinking about managing the last-minute questions, we've seen how the guide for learners can be extremely useful, and it gives us an opportunity to deal with those questions that students might not ask unless you give them the opportunity to ask those questions. And of course, not worrying about the question that they haven't asked you will just add to the stress on the exam day. So we really need to get those questions out before they get to the exam. And then, of course, we've got some sample ideas for teaching, revising, and exploiting the context of the countdown and helping students to plan towards that, that final run up to the exam to help them be more confident. And of course, I hope you will see we've got some resources for you to share and some ideas to explore that we hope will help your students be more confident, more prepared, and be able to showcase what they know on the exam day. And we have lots of references for you. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the webinar, we will be sending you the recording next week. And with the recording, we will be sending you a list of useful links, including the ones that you can see on the screen and some others, so that you can take this forward in your countdown for your learners' exam day. Now, I think that leaves us for a little time for a couple of questions. So, let's have a look at the questions and answers, see if we can answer some of these. Okay, so how long in advance of the exam would you do this prep? Now, of course, that will depend on the length of your exam course. It will depend, and this is something that you will need to decide, because obviously it depends on how many hours you have before how many times you're going to see the students before the exam, etc. So it's something that you need to think about in your particular context, but just to kind of consider, there is a countdown. What would be useful for my students to do to revise their strategies for each part of the exam and to have the opportunity to ask questions, as we said. So I think that's quite important. If they're the writing part of the exam, do they have a second answer sheet? No, they don't. So it's very important that they use the question paper and the answer sheet appropriately. So if they're making notes, they might be doing that on a separate piece of paper. Or they can actually write notes on the answer sheet and then they cross them out. This is in the paper-based, of course. And when they're doing the computer-based, they may be writing on the screen and making corrections on the screen. So that will be much easier. Now, when it says, should we encourage candidates not to write a draft of their writing task? To be honest, I would say yes. It's best to use time planning so that when they do start writing, they're better prepared. So, because one of the problems with the draft is that they have to copy it onto the answer sheet. So the time they're taking doing the copying means that they haven't got time to edit or perhaps to be expanding their answer. And of course, the writing doesn't have to be beautiful. It has to be clear. And so if a student makes a mistake or decides to change something, they clearly make it clear that's being crossed out, and then they continue writing. So that is important in terms of how they manage their time, which is why I think is also thinking about timed practice before the exam, particularly for writing. Okay, let's have a little look. There's lots of questions about writing and wrong spelling. Well, obviously, at the higher levels, spelling, of course, is not, if it's affecting comprehensibility, then it will it create a negative experience on the reader. So I think it would really depend on how often they were making spelling mistakes, because obviously even a slip in writing may be that they've written the word incorrectly. But of course, if they're doing that a lot, then it will have a negative impact on the reader. And of course, it's something to be considering, certainly at these higher levels. I think we've got time for one more question. I'm looking at, okay. It's interesting that the Gabrielles have very positive experience, and obviously it's difficult if you're having such a positive experience to because it means that you're preparing them well and that you've understood what the requirements of the level. So I would just encourage you to consider that the handbook is a guide for everyone for what needs to be covered and the levels to be achieved. And I'm very sorry, but I think we've run out of time. So it gives me just to say thank you very much indeed. I'm sorry we weren't able to answer all your questions, but thank you very much for joining us today. Thank you to Paola and Steve Eva, who've been working away dealing with the chat, and I wish you and all your students all the best in their exams, and thank you again for joining us today. Goodbye for now.
Bye-bye.